pleasure for me to be here. So indeed, as you can read on the screen, today I'm going to discuss cosmic inflation and quantum mechanics. And what I want to do in this talk is to argue that cosmic inflation is not only a nice framework to understand the physical conditions that prevailed in the early universe, but it's also an interesting playground to understand some of the main issues of quantum mechanics. So what I will try to do in this talk is to use cosmic inflation in order to learn something, possibly, about quantum mechanics. So I have organized the talk into three different parts. So the first one will be a crash course on cosmic inflation. This will be inflation in brief. So I will remind you about the basics principle and about the observational status of inflation. Then I will focus on a specific part of the inflationary scenario, which is the theory of cosmological fluctuations of quantum origin. And in the third part, I will use what I have introduced before to discuss a fancy question, namely, can we see some quantum mechanical signature in the sky? And finally, I will present some recap and conclusions. So let's start with the first part, a brief reminder of what inflation is. So inflation is a phase of accelerated expansion that took place in the early universe. And it's interesting to consider this phase of evolution because this can help us to solve the puzzles of the standard model of cosmology. So this is here the timeline of the universe. So we are here. This is the Big Bang. This is the last scattering surface where the CMB anisotropies and the CMB were produced. And so inflation is supposed to have taken place somewhere here in the very, very early universe. And during that phase of inflation, the universe experienced an exponential growth. And you can see it here. The scale factor, which is the quantity which tells you about the dynamic of the universe, is growing a lot here. And then at the end of inflation, we connect inflation with the subsequent radiation and matter-dominated era, that is to say the standard hot Big Bang model. So inflation is characterized essentially by one parameter, which is the expansion rate during inflation. So this is the Hubble parameter during inflation, which is just A dot over A, where a dot means a derivative with respect to time. And to give you an idea, today, the expansion is characterized by an expansion rate, which is in natural units, 10 to the minus 42 GeV. So this means by particle physics standards, the current expansion is a very low energy phenomenon. And we don't know exactly what was the expansion rate of the universe during inflation, but we know that it was somewhere between 10 to the 13 GeV and 10 to the minus 22 GeV. So this shows you that in comparison to the natural energy scale now, inflation is a high energy phenomenon. And this is why it will have some connections with high energy physics, such as particle physics, or extension of the standard model of particle physics. Now, how can we realize inflation in practice? So inflation is usually driven by a scalar field. And why is it so? It's simply because if you calculate the energy density of a scalar field, it's given by the kinetic energy of the field plus the potential energy. But the pressure is given by the kinetic energy minus the potential energy. So this means that if you have a flat potential, the field will roll down the flat potential very slowly because the potential is flat. Therefore, the kinetic energy will be very small. It will be subdominant compared to the potential energy. And therefore, the pressure of the system will be negative. And negative pressure in the context of general relativity means accelerated expansion. And this is the very definition of inflation. So this is the what we call the slow roll phase of inflation. But we also have to stop inflation because we don't want to spoil the successes of the hot Big Bang phase. And so how is it achieved in the context of inflation? It's achieved because at some point, usually close to the ground state of the system, which means close to the minimum of the potential will no longer be flat enough to support inflation. And therefore, the field will start to accelerate. This means that the kinetic energy will no longer be negligible compared to the potential energy. And therefore, inflation will stop because the pressure will become positive. The field, usually the field will start to oscillate at the bottom of the potential. It will decay. The decay products will thermalize. And this is how you smoothly connect inflation with the radiation-dominated era. So this is the broad picture that we have in mind when we talk about inflation. And I have said that inflation is characterized by essentially, one energy scale, which is the Hubble parameter. It's also interesting to consider the inverse of this parameter, which is the Hubble radius. So the Hubble radius in cosmology is a lens which tells you whether you are sensitive to the expansion of the universe. So if you consider a physical phenomenon taking place on scales which are much smaller than the Hubble radius, then you don't care about the fact that the universe is expanding. This is exactly what is happening in this room. The size of this room is absolutely tiny compared to the Hubble radius today. And if we want to do tabletop experiments in physics, we don't need to take into account the fact that the universe is expanding. And on the contrary, if you consider some physical phenomenon characterized by a lens which is of the order of the Hubble radius or larger than the Hubble radius, then of course taking into account the fact that the universe is expanding becomes compulsory. And so it's nice to know in this model of cosmology where I have inflation and then the Big Bang phase, it's interesting to know how this Hubble parameter behaves. So this is a plot of the Hubble parameter. In fact, it's logarithm versus the logarithm of the scale factor, a quantity which is also known as number of e-folds, but which is a measure of time. So this is Hubble parameter versus time. So the Hubble radius during inflation is almost a constant. And then when inflation stops, it starts to grow. And it grows at a different rate depending on the equation of state of the dominant stuff in the universe. And this is why you don't have the same slope for radiation or for matter. And then if you consider a given scale, let's say a wavelength of some wave or wavelength of some Fourier wavelength, this quantity will also grow with time because it's like drawing a small wave on a balloon. If you inflate the balloon, then the wave at the surface will acquire a larger wavelength, and therefore it will grow with time. So this is what I have tried to represent here. So a wavelength, so inversely proportional to the wave number, So a given scale will be proportional to the scale factor, therefore will be growing with the expansion of the universe. And typically, this means that it will start within the Hubble radius originally, then will cross out the Hubble radius during inflation, spend some time outside the Hubble radius, and will re-enter the Hubble radius either during the radiation or matter-dominated epochs, depending on its wave number. And this is the typical evolution of the Hubble radius in our model. Okay, so this is a broad description of inflation. Now let me say a few words about the observational constraints that we have on inflation. So this will be very quick, because it could be another talk. So you probably know that the problem is not to find a model of inflation. The problem is rather to choose among the hundreds of models of inflation that are on the market, what is the best one. And so here, this is a complicated plot, so I am not going to explain everything, but let me just describe this plot a little bit for you. So here, there is a quantity which represents the model, the performance of a given model of inflation. So if you wish, its ability to fit the data. So in technical terms, this is the Bayesian evidence for those who are familiar with statistics. But this is a number which tells me if a given model of inflation fits the data well or not. And so if I am here on the right-hand side, the model is good. If I am on the left-hand side, the model does not fit the data very well. And here, on the vertical axis, I have represented a quantity which measures the constraints for a specific model that we have on the reheating. So if I am at the bottom of the graph, it means that the data are not accurate enough to be able to say something relevant about reheating. If I am at the top of the graph, on the contrary, the data are accurate enough to say something about reheating for a specific model. So model performance versus constraints on reheating, and each circle represents a model of inflation. So you have on this plot something like 200 different models of inflation. And so this means that the good models should be here. And hopefully, I would like to have good constraints on reheating, but of course, this is something that I do not control. So I would like to be up in the graph. And from such a graph, I can decide what is the best model of inflation. The best model of inflation is obviously the one which has the best model performance. And therefore, the winner is, according to the Planck data, the winner is a very famous model of inflation, which is the Starobinsky model. The Starobinsky model so was proposed by Starobinsky even before the Alan Guse paper. So it was proposed by Starobinsky in 79, so before Guse paper, which was published in 81. And it's a model where the potential has this form. So it has a plateau at infinity. It is flat at infinity. And so this is the model which has the largest Bayesian evidence using technical words. And something also which is non-trivial and that you can also extract from the previous plot is that also one of the most popular models of inflation, namely M square phi square or lambda phi to the four, that people usually call chaotic inflation, even if this is not appropriate. It should be called large field inflation. Well, anyway, according to the Planck data, these models, which were also very popular at the beginning, it would not change a lot. It would not change a lot. Here, this is Planck only, CMB, it's true. But this would not modify those conclusions. Of course, this would modify slightly the constraints that you get on the parameters that describe those models, but this conclusion would not be changed. And so I was saying that these models of large field model, they are now almost ruled out by the Planck data. So the conclusion is that if you want to build a good model of inflation, the potential should not be like that, but it should be something like that. And this is the main message from the Planck data. Okay, so this was a very brief and simple descriptions of the present status of inflation. And now let me consider the theory of cosmological fluctuations. So this theory of cosmological fluctuation is very important for the inflationary theories, because this is how, this is with the help of this theory that you can derive the predictions of inflation. So this is really the tool which allows you to make the connection between the theory and the observations. So, well, we know that there are inhomogeneities in the universe, it's obvious. So the Friedman universe approach is not enough to have a good description and a fair description of our universe. And so we see the galaxies, we see the CMB anisotropies, so we have inhomogeneities in our universe. And given that fact, we would like to know how do they grow, and we would like to know their origin. So how those homogeneities grow, we think that we know the answer, and the answer is gravitational instability. And so the idea is, of course, quite simple, is that if you have by chance locally some upper density, then the gravitational field will be slightly more important, therefore it will attract stuff. But if there is more stuff locally, this will boost the gravitational field, therefore it will attract even more stuff, and so on. And this is how the structures can grow. And this is confirmed by the observation, simply by the fact that today the inhomogeneities are of order 1, while in the very early universe, and we know that from the observation of the CMB, they were small, of the order of 10 to the minus 5, which is the delta T over T that we see. So we believe that the CMB anisotropies that we observe on the last scattering surface are just the seeds of the structure that we see today. And in between, they have just grown by gravitational instability.
The time required for the instability to grow with that factor, does it also match from the last scattering surface to the present distance?
Yes, but you know that this was one of the first arguments for dark matter. If you don't put dark matter, then you have a problem with this question. So, yes. But what about the origin of the fluctuations? Because, okay, we have a mechanism to grow the fluctuation, but if we have nothing at the beginning, there is nothing to grow, and therefore we cannot explain the structure that we see today. So according to inflation, the origin of those fluctuations are the quantum fluctuations of the inflaton field, the scalar field which is responsible for inflation, and of the gravitational field, because the two are coupled through the Einstein equation. So if I were a bit provocative, but I am not, but I would say that this mechanism has something to do with quantum gravity, because we are going to consider quantum fluctuations of the inflaton field, okay, but also of the gravitational field.
But what about thermal fluctuations? They're not
It's not that they are, well, it, if you, so, yes, good question. You could also assume some thermal fluctuation. Well, first of all, you have to say thermal fluctuation of what? But if you start, I mean, if you give a meaning to thermal fluctuation and if you start initially with thermal fluctuations, it does not work because you does not fit the power spectrum for the fluctuation that we see in the CMB. So we believe that, so inflation is here. We believe that we have the Friedmann universe, which is homogeneous and isotropic. And on top of that, we have small fluctuations. They are small because we know they are small from the observation of the CMB. Delta T over T is 10 to the minus 5. And the small fluctuation stand on top of this homogeneous universe, which is expanding. So if you wish, it's a bit like having a crystal with some phonons on top of the crystal, except that in our case, of course, the crystal is expanding. So now let me spend a few slides on some technical aspect of this theory, because I hope this can be useful. So the first thing is that, as I was mentioning, we know that the fluctuations were small in the early universe. And therefore, it's a good news because it means that a perturbative approach will be available. And in the following, I will consider only linear perturbations. So technically, what does it mean? It means that we take our homogeneous and isotropic inflaton field, and we add a small fluctuation, delta phi. So delta phi is supposed to be small compared to phi. And you see that the background scalar field, it depends on time only because of homogeneity, but our fluctuation, they also depend on space. And we do the same for the gravitational field, so the scale factor, which depends only on time. We perturb this scale factor, and we introduce a perturbation which is small and which also depends on space. So we have two quantities. We have a quantity which describes the fluctuation of the scalar field, of the inflaton field, and we have a quantity which describes the metric perturbations. But in fact, these two quantities, they are related by the perturbed Einstein equation. So it should be possible to express everything in terms of a single quantity. And this single quantity, for those who are familiar with inflation, is very well known. It's named the Mukhanov-Sasaki variable. And you see that it is a combination of the delta phi and of this object, which is known as the Bardeen potential. So we can, the bottom line is that we can describe the amplitude of those small fluctuations by a single variable, which is the Mukhanov-Sasaki variable. So the physical interpretation of this quantity is just the amplitude of the fluctuation from place to place. And since we do a linear theory, it's always convenient to go to Fourier space because each mode will evolve independently. And therefore, I will be interested in the following, in the Fourier amplitude of my Mukhanov-Sasaki variable. No, because there is only 1 degree of freedom left in this problem. Because the other combinations are not free functions, if you wish. They are determined by the system. Because we have a description of the scalar field, a description of the metric, but we have the perturbed Einstein equation between them.
So you're assuming that the cosmological perturbation is only through the scale factor.
No, so this is a slope. You mean this equation? No, this is a slopy notation. Of course, what you do when you develop the theory of cosmological perturbation is that you introduce each term of the metric is perturbed, and then you carefully construct gauge invariant variables and so on. So, behind this slopy notation, there is a full theory, the theory of gauge invariant cosmological perturbation. And in addition, this is scalar perturbations, but we also have gravitational waves, which are not included here. And therefore, well, we know in which quantity we are interested, and now we would like to derive an equation of motion for this quantity. So what we need to do is to calculate, if you wish, the Hamiltonian of the system. And so what you do is you take the action of the system. The action of the system is the Einstein-Hilbert action, the action of the gravitational field, plus the action of a scalar field, the inflaton field, and you expand everything at second order, because you want to vary the action to get first order equations of motion. And from the action, you derive the Hamiltonian. So there is no, it's a very robust calculation. It follows from, really from first principles. And the Hamiltonian that you find is this one. So this one should be very familiar. This is nothing but the Hamiltonian of an oscillator. So P is the conjugate momentum. So there is an integral over d3k. This means that I have a collections of different oscillators with different values for different modes, as usual in field theory. You have the kinetic term, P square. You have something which is quadratic in the amplitude. So this is like x square. And we have omega square here. So it's like an Hamiltonian of an oscillator in a standard textbook of classical mechanics. It's P square plus omega square x square. This is what we get. Except that the omega square is given by this. So epsilon 1 is known as the first row parameters, but this is not important here. You see that this quantity, the effective frequency of the oscillator, is time dependent. And its time dependence is given by a quite complicated expression, but it depends only on the scale factor and its derivative up to first order. So this means that if you know the scale factor, so if you know how the universe is expanding, you can calculate the time dependence of the frequency of the oscillator.
It can also turn negative.
Yes, and this is very fortunate because this is how you grow the fluctuations during inflation. And well, if you take this Hamiltonian and derive the Hamilton equations of motion from this Hamiltonian, you find the equation of motion for the Mukhanov-Sasaki variable, and this is what you obtain. So no surprise at this stage, you obtain the equation of an oscillator with a frequency which was given by that term. So actually, this is not exactly the equation of a harmonic oscillator. This is the equation of a parametric oscillator. So an harmonic oscillator would be a pendulum, like that. And a parametric oscillator is a pendulum, the length of which can change with time. So this is what we have. And of course, the variation of the length of my parametric oscillator is completely determined by the dynamics of the background. Because if I know the scale factor, I know the time dependence of this. And then I want to consider the quantum version of this theory, because my crucial assumption about inflation is that the perturbations are of quantum mechanical origin. Well, very easy. We have to quantize an harmonic oscillator, well, a parametric oscillator. So we can write the Schrödinger equation for the wave function of the Mukhanov-Sasaki variable. So I times the time derivative of the state is equal to the Hamiltonian applied to the wave function. So P square, as usual, gives minus d2 over dx square, if you wish, but here x is the Mukhanov-Sasaki variable, plus omega square times the wave function. And if I want to know the time evolution of my wave function, I have to solve this Schrödinger equation. And since this is a Gaussian theory, I mean, the action is still quadratic, it's very easy to solve this equation. And the solution is a Gaussian state, which is given here. The only difference is that since the frequency is a time-dependent quantity, the variance of my Gaussian state will be a time-dependent quantity.
This is the ground state of
yours. This is the ground. So let me answer this question in the following slides, okay?
Are you assuming adiabatic?
No. It's an exact solution of the Schrödinger equations here. I am not assuming anything. K is a continuous variable, yes, so, and it makes sense because V is a field, so in fact what I am computing here is not a wave function, it's a wave functional that I can always write as an infinite product of wave functions, an infinite product of the various wave numbers. Yes, so you go too fast. Wait, I will consider this question in details in the following. So all the answers will be in the following slides. Yes, so we have some normalization, but you see that my wave function is characterized by here it's this capital omega k, so it depends on k, it depends on time, so this means that I have a Gaussian state with a time-dependent frequency, and of course it does not come as a surprise that you can compute the time dependence of the variance of the state. So you can write in this way, and the F, which is here, obeys this equation, which is exactly the equation for the Mukhanov-Sasaki variable. So this means that if you can solve the equation for the Mukhanov-Sasaki variable, given some scale factor, you can know exactly the time dependence of the wave function. And now the initial conditions, your question, well, one of the two questions. So the key assumption of inflation is that we start from the vacuum state. So what does that mean? Well, you just open a textbook on quantum mechanics and you find the ground state for that anharmonic oscillator. This means that this omega k here should be k over 2. And then this gives you the ground state of the harmonic oscillator. So we choose the initial conditions such that initially capital omega k is k over 2. And physically, this means that we start the evolution of those quantum fluctuations from the ground state. So this answers the question for the initial conditions. And then, is it really always the ground state?
Sorry, why the limit?
So I explain why there is the limit. So what we have in mind is this. So you recognize this plot. This is again the evolution of the Hubble radius versus time. And here, this is a given length scale. So now you can think about these curves as different physical wavelengths for different Fourier modes. They grow like A, and therefore they behave like that. So initially, the wavelength of a perturbation is much smaller than the Hubble radius, hence the limit. This means that we go really deep inside the Hubble radius initially, and this is here that we fix the initial conditions. So here I have represented the state by its Wigner function. So the Wigner function of a Gaussian state is a Gaussian state, so this is what we have, and you see that the beauty of inflation is that it allows you to fix well-defined initial conditions simply because you have to fix the initial condition on scales that are much smaller than the Hubble radius. So the modes, if you wish, they do not fill the expansion of space-time, and therefore you can choose the vacuum state in a well-defined way. Without inflation, the Hubble radius would have continued to behave like that, and the mode would have been outside the Hubble radius, and it would have been impossible to fix well-defined initial conditions. So if you can also inflation is something that solves the puzzles of the standard model, you can also see inflation as a kind of theoretical machinery which allows you to fix well-defined initial conditions in the early universe. And those initial conditions, again, are just the ground state of an oscillator. But because of the time dependence of the background, the mode will cross out the Hubble radius during inflation. And here, of course, they will start to feel the fact that they live in an expanding universe. And as a consequence, the variance of the wave function will start to depend on time. And this is what you see here. The wave function that was just a symmetric Gaussian initially, because of the time dependence of the background on scales larger than the Hubble radius, it will start to evolve in time. And this is a representation of the Wigner function of the state, or the time evolution of the Wigner function of the state as it goes, as it cross out the Hubble radius and reach very large scales, very large scales at the end of inflation and then during radiation and matter dominated era. So what is this? No, because everything, it's a quadratic theory, so everything is exact. So we can really, this is textbook.
Variation of the frequency is slow.
No, if you have in mind something like W dot over W squared, so it's not adiabatic here. And we understand why it's not adiabatic here, because you see, initially this was the vacuum state, but here it's no longer the vacuum state. So if it's not the vacuum state, it means that it's a state that contains particles, okay? And so what we are witnessing here is creation of particles due to the expansion of space-time. And so creation of particles in field theory cannot be the adiabatic regime. And so we have this state here. So far I was discussing scalar perturbation, so you have no gravitons in that case, but I could reproduce the discussion for tensor mode, so gravitational waves, and it will proceed exactly the same way. So during inflation, yes, this includes quantum productions of gravitons, if you wish.
Sorry, why is it important for it to be within the horizon for it for you to assume that it's in the ground state?
No, it's not exactly like that. It's because, in quantum field theory in Kerr space-time, you know that the meaning of a ground state or the vacuum state is not very well defined. It's ambiguous. But in this regime, for those modes, since we are really inside the Hubble radius, for those modes, it's like Minkowski. So it's like ordinary quantum field theory. And then the notion of a ground state is no longer ambiguous. But nevertheless, there is still the assumption that we start from the ground state. I could imagine starting from excited states, for instance. If you want to start from excited states, you run into many problems. The first one is you have to say which excited states and why. If you are really far from an excited state, this will affect the predictions of inflation, and what we see does not seem to indicate some deviation. And moreover, if you start from a state which is not the vacuum, this means that you have initially particles in it. If you put too much particles, the energy density that they carry could prevent the start of inflation, which would not be a good thing. So they, So in other words, the energy density associated to these particles could back react on the geometry and could prevent the start of inflation. So it's not a theorem. There are ways around this, but okay. Nevertheless, I think these are good reasons to motivate the initial state. And so we have this state. This state is still a Gaussian state. It's just that the variance is changing with time, but it's still exponential minus V2. So what is this state? Well, this state is very well known in physics. This is a two-mode squeezed state. So people who are, for instance, working in quantum optics, they work with this state every day. And we find exactly the same state in cosmology. And you see, this follows really from basic principles. You take Einstein-Hilbert action, GR plus a scalar field. You do perturbation theory. You quantize. You find a two-mode squeezed state. So it's interesting to discuss this two-mode squeezed state. But there was a question. I also come to this question, but very quickly, the two modes are because you extract particles from the vacuum, but you have to conserve momentum. So in fact, you will not create particles, you will create pairs of particles, one with k and the other with minus k in order to conserve momentum. So the two modes come from the k and the minus k. You mean in the case of an excited state? Here, here. Well, I would say that if. So, what's your question? Is the energy? Yes. So, the energy density carried by those fluctuations in the vacuum state would be. So if you go to first order, so if you consider first order theory, they do not back react. You have to go to second order in order to calculate the perturbed stress energy tensor, which would tell you the amplitude of the energy density. And so you have something like something which is quadratic in the amplitude of the fluctuation, the amplitude of the fluctuation being something like being smaller than 10 to the minus 5, this would be an effect of the order of 10 to the minus 10. So completely negligible, I believe. OK. And well, this framework that I have just described for you is very, very successful, as I said at the beginning of the talk. Because, well, the Mukhanov-Sasaki variable, it's in some sense, it's the same as curvature perturbation, which are delta T over T. So the V, the quantum V in the during inflation are the seeds for the CMB. And therefore, you can then try to study the properties of those fluctuations produced during inflation. Mm-hmm. And one way to study their properties is to calculate their correlation functions. So you start with the two-point correlation function. And in Fourier space, the two-point correlation function is the power spectrum. So you calculate the power spectrum. And for a model of inflation, this gives a power law with some spectral index. And the predictions of inflation is that this NS should be close to 1, but not 1. And this is a prediction in the sense that this calculation was done before it was checked with the observation. So it's not a post-diction, it's a prediction. And the Planck data, they tell us that NS is 0.96. So the Planck data, this is the first time that we have a statistically significant measurement of the fact of the deviation from one of the spectral index at more than 5 sigma. So this is very, very important. And we have we have the number for the amplitude, and of course, as expected, the amplitude is of the order of 10 to the minus 10, because the power spectrum, again, is the square of the amplitude. The amplitude is 10 to the minus 5, so you find something of the order of 10 to the minus 10. Okay, so this is nice. It works well. And something which is maybe less known is that there is another predictions of inflation, which is also very important. And these predictions of inflation is that the curvature perturbations on large scale should be a constant, and with very exquisite precision. So it means that its derivative should be extremely small. In fact, you can estimate that the time derivative of the curvature perturbation should be something of the order of exponential minus 50. So why is there minus 50? It's because this is the number of e-folds that you get from the time at which you cross out the horizon, the Hubble radius during inflation and the end of inflation. And why is it very important to have this? Because you can show that this property is responsible for these peaks that we see in the CMB. So you see here an history of the measurement of those peaks. So here what I have plotted is the power spectrum of the CMB fluctuation versus the angular scale. So you have some fluctuation on the celestial sphere, and you can measure the amplitude of the signal at some scales, and you can change the scale. So power of the signal versus scale. Here, small value of L means very large scale. Large values of L means small scales. And you see that, well, we have these peaks, the Doppler peaks. And you see that in the 90s, we could barely see the rise of the first peak. Then came WMAP, and now we have Planck. And we see really those peaks. And without this property, which is true for inflation, those peaks would not have been present. So for those of you who remember the 80s, at that time, inflation had a competitor for structure formation. It was topological defects. And the structure formation for topological defects also predicts the shape of this curve, but predicts no peak. And this is the reason, we see the peaks, and this is the reason why the assumption that the structures come from topological defect is now ruled out. So this is also something which is very important, but which is less often discussed, I believe.
This deviation of MS from unity,
well, in various ways, but mainly it will slightly tilt the plateau that you have here. So NS1, which people called scale invariance, you would get a plateau which is exactly flat here. If you slightly tilt the power spectrum, then you would slightly introduce a slope here. So let me discuss again this, since this is important, because it seems that this is a model that works very well. Let me discuss again these questions of the quantum mechanical origin of the perturbations. So you see, I have showed the mechanism in the Schrödinger picture. The operators do not depend on time, and the wave function, the state, was depending on time. Of course, you can also describe the same phenomenon in the Heisenberg picture. This is what you have here. So this is the Hamiltonian in the Heisenberg picture. You recognize here the sum, well, the Hamiltonian for a collection of harmonic oscillator, so creation and annihilation operators. And then here, you have what I would call an interaction Hamiltonian. and you see that you have k minus k. And this k minus k is responsible for the fact that you create particles with k and particles with minus k. And this term is proportional to a quantity which depends only on the derivative of the scale factor. So if you consider the same field in a non-dynamical background, you don't have this term, and therefore you don't have particle creation. So it's really because my perturbation live in a dynamical space-time that I have particle creations. And people from quantum optics, they call this term the pump source, the pump field. The pump field would be the scalar field in my case. So you may think that, okay, this is early universe, this is inflation, this is maybe a bit exotic. But in fact, I am going to argue that this mechanism is not exotic at all, and it is in fact a well-known mechanism in quantum field theory, known for a very long time. And this mechanism is exactly the same as the Schwinger effect in quantum field theory. So Schwinger effect is a well-known effect in field theory. It was computed by Schwinger in the 50s. And it's interesting because it is one of the few examples in field theory where you can do everything exactly. You don't need perturbation theory. Actually, the Schwinger effect is a non-perturbative effect. And No. This term comes from GR and the scalar field. There is no assumption. Just it comes from the Einstein-Hilbert, if you wish. It's just the same Hamiltonian that I showed before, except that, as usual for the harmonic oscillator, you express P and X in terms of the creation and annihilation operator, and then you get that. Sure, here it's linear perturbation theory. But again, the perturbations are extremely small and we know it from the observations. So the additional terms would be really small. So what is the Schwinger effect? The Schwinger effect is the fact that if you consider a Dirac field that would describe an electron and a positron, and if this Dirac field interacts with a constant electric field, you can create electrons and positrons under the influence of this electric field. So you take the Dirac equation, if you wish. You have the covariant derivative, which depends on the gauge field because of the interaction. So the Dirac field is viewed as a quantum field. But the electric field, which is the source, is viewed as a classical source. You do not quantize the source. And a constant electric field means a time-dependent gauge field, because the gauge field, you have to differentiate to get the, okay? And so there will be some time dependence coming from the covariant derivative in your Dirac equation. And if you consider the Fourier transform of the Dirac field in this context, you get the equation of a parametric oscillator. Exactly the same physics. So
you also get an essential singularity in 1 over h?
No. So you get the fact that your field has a frequency which depends on time, but since the source is different, the time dependence of the frequency is different. In fact, in the case of the Schwinger effect, you get something, the dependence of the frequency. For inflation, it was k squared minus 1 over the time squared.
So the problem with it is the 1 over e, so that the electric field goes to 0, it's an essential singularity.
Absolutely, it's a non-perturbative effect. Right. Yes, absolutely. But you know, the Schwinger effect, you have the interaction of a quantum field with a classical source. As a result, you have particle creation due to this classical source. And you can compute the effect. And of course, the effect is controlled by E, the magnitude or the strength of the source. It's exactly the same thing for inflation. you replace electrons and positrons by the inhomogeneous gravity field. The source is, of course, the dynamics of space-time, so it's controlled by the scale factor. And the amplitude of the effect is controlled by the relevant parameter that we have in this game, namely H, which the Hubble parameter that controls the strength of the source. And you find that the amplitude, so AS, the number that I have showed before, is proportional to H squared in the case of inflation. So it's in fact a very common and well-known effect in field theory. Inflation is nothing but a cosmological Schwinger effect. So if you now write the two-mode squeezed state, not in the Schrödinger picture, but in the, well, in terms of those states, which are the state, the eigenstates of the operator, the number operator. So you obtain something which is a tensorial product of k minus k, reflecting the fact that you create particle with k and particle with minus k. So this is what you obtain, and this is, again, a state which is well known in quantum optics. This is a two-mode squeezed state. It's characterized by the squeezing parameter and the squeezing angle. Squeezing parameter r, squeezing angle phi. And well, you know that CMB is the most accurate black body ever produced in nature. We are not able in the lab to produce a black body which is as accurate as this one. So this is, you have here the Kobe measurement here at the red point. The black body spectrum is the green line. And in fact, the error bar have been magnified by 400. Otherwise, you would not see them given the thickness of the line. So this is the most accurate black body ever produced in nature. But for the perturbation, so the CMB, in fact, is the strongest squeezed state ever produced in nature. Because people doing quantum optics, so apparently there is a competition, namely, what will be the lab will achieve the record for R. It's apparently very challenging technologically to get R to be larger than a few. 1, 2 is already considered as something really difficult. In cosmology, the R at the end of inflation is of the order of 100. So not only this is, in cosmology, we have the best black body ever produced, but we have also the strongest squeezed state ever produced in nature. And this two-mode squeezed state is also an entangled state. So in fact, if you send the parameter R, which describes the squeezing, to infinity, the limit of this state is the EPR state, so the state that was considered by Einstein, Podolsky, and Rosen to discuss the issues, according to them, of quantum mechanics. So the limit of this state when R goes to infinity is the EPR state. And this means that apparently, and a priori, we have strong correlations, quantum correlations, between the wave number k and minus k. This is what it is telling us. So this is telling us that this object should be something which is very quantum, which contains huge quantum correlation. So now the questions, and I think I am approaching my time, right? But I have still a few slides. So this led us naturally to the question, can we see quantum mechanical effects in the sky? According to inflation, we may think that it should be possible. So when you have an harmonic oscillator, so you have creation and annihilation operator, and you can construct the number operator, which is a dagger. So n is the eigenvector of this operator. That is not No. Here, the n is the same here. So you have a sum. So this state is 1k, 1k, plus 2k, 2 minus k, and so on.
What is the limiting form of this?
I don't know. So in real space, so if you write the wave function in real, which correspond to this state in real space, this is just a delta function of the two position of the two particles. But in this case, I must say that I don't remember. Sure. So the full state is an infinite product of those states for various k. The full wave function is a product of a k of the.
Okay.
Ah, the tensor mode is exactly the same. Absolutely, yes. Except that we have not yet detected the tensor mode. So that. Yes. You know, you start from the vacuum, and because of the interaction with the dynamical background, you create particles under the influence of this source, and those are these particles. Exactly. They are manifesting themselves through this map, because what you see here are the fluctuations, right? And well, the fact that we have particles, so this is not the vacuum state. So this is something which is not invariant by translation, means that you have inhomogeneities. So this state is not invariant by translation, contrary to the vacuum state. And therefore, you see it.
So astrophysically, what's the observable that you look for this?
Astrophysically, what you can see is the power spectrum of that. So you see the two-point correlation function of V in this state.
But that will convert into some correlation function of the temperature anisotropy.
Yes, because V is roughly speaking delta T over T. Okay. Roughly speaking. That mode to decay in the. No, this has nothing to do with that. The
pair. What we see here are the, you know, the radiation coming, right? Which are standard model things.
Yes, but the inhomogeneities, I mean, they continue to live their life outside the Hubble radius even after the end of inflation. And in addition, I have shown that zeta is conserved, so the power spectrum remains unaffected on large scale, but what's going on small scale during reheating or. Yeah. So this state, according to this framework, is really something that we should see in the CMB. Yes. Yes. Yes, so this means that R, the squeezing parameter, and phi, the squeezing angle, are functions of time. So can we see quantum mechanics in the sky? So let me first introduce, so it's a slight aside, to discuss what is known as quantum discord. which is a recent concept of quantum information theory. And why do I want to discuss quantum discord? Because quantum discord is the tool that tells you whether a given quantum state contains non-classical correlations. So we want to make sure that our two-mode squeezed state contains non-classical correlations. And for this purpose, we have to calculate the quantum discord. So let me, I will just show you the result, but let me discuss what the quantum discord is. So you know that classically, you know that the Shannon entropy given a system given by this equation measure our ignorance about the system. So for instance, if you have a die with two sides, right, the probability, if the probability to see one side is p, the probability to see the other side is 1 minus p, because the sum of the probabilities have to be 1. This means that the Shannon entropy in that case is given by this. And if you plot this Shannon entropy versus p, this gives this curve. Very easy to interpret. If p is 0, this means that the first probability is 0, the other one is 1. There is absolutely no ignorance at all about the system. We have a definite prediction, so the entropy is 0. If p is 1, the first probability is 1, but the second is 0. This is, again, a situation where we don't have any ignorance. And of course, if p is 1/2, then the two probabilities are 1/2 and 1/2, and therefore our ignorance reaches its maximum. So this is the usual concept of entropy. Now there is another quantity that the people have introduced. This is the mutual information. So the mutual information measure the degrees in our ignorance when we about some random process, when we find the value of another random process. So imagine that you have a bipartite system. It's made of two subsystems, X and wire. They are a priori correlated. If you learn something about wire, since wire is correlated to X, a priori, this is going to decrease your ignorance about X. And this quantity, which is the entropy of X and the conditional of entropy of X knowing wire, measure this. And classically, you can show that this is given by I, which is given by this expression. Again, it's very easy to understand why. Assume that X and wire are completely independent. If they are independent, this means that the entropy should be SX plus S wire. In that case, I is 0. But it makes sense, because if you learn something about wire and wire is completely disconnected from X, you are not to decrease your ignorance about X by learning something about wire. So this equation makes sense. So quantum mechanically, you can define an entropy given a quantum state of a system, the density matrix. And this is the usual equation, which is very similar to the Shannon equation. So this is the way to define entropy in quantum mechanics. And then the crucial step is that the difference between I and J, so the two definitions of the mutual entropy, which is necessarily zero in classical theory, is not necessarily zero in quantum theory. And so the difference between the two is a quantity which measures whether you have quantum correlations or not in the system. If the quantum discord is zero, then you only have classical correlation. If it's not zero, then you have quantum correlations within a bipartite system. But this is the idea of quantum discord. So it has been introduced by Zurek 10 years ago. Now it's a very important tool in quantum information theory. And
I think what you say, even against classical correlation,
Yes. Because classical correlations. Yes. So you have correlation. So it's you should make the difference between I between being zero and the difference of the two being zero. So if I is zero, you don't have correlation between the two. If the discord is zero, you can have correlation, but those correlations are classical. So what we have done recently is that we have computed the quantum discord for the two-mode squeezed state. And you see that initially this is zero. So initially, I mean in the ground state where the squeezing parameter is zero, this is zero. And again, it makes sense because we start from the ground state, which is a coherent state. And we know that the coherent state are very classical state. If you consider the motion of a coherent state in phase space, this is a small bump that follows the classical trajectory. So it's something which is very classical. And as a result, the discord is zero. But then, as R is growing, the discord is growing. So really, this means that the quantum state of the perturbation in the CMB is a discordant state and should therefore contain quantum correlations between mod k and minus k. So can we prove that it's very in phase space, yes, in phase space. Mean opposite wave number. Not completely obvious to go from, in that case, from Fourier space to real space. So let me, I think I am running out of time, right? So I should speed up. I'm sorry about this. So let me first try to see whether we can reproduce all the observations with a classical state. What is a classical state? Is a state that has a vanishing discord. So if I assume that the quantum state is a state with zero discord, am I doing something wrong? Am I doing something which is in contradiction with the observations? So the first thing that I can do is to try to reproduce the power spectrum, so the two-point correlation functions. So if I choose, so you see a classical state, so this is a general theorem. Any state with vanishing discord can always be decomposed in this way. If I carefully, where P and M are arbitrary coefficients, if I carefully choose the P and M according to this, you see, it depends on the squeezing parameter. Obtaining this state, I can show that the power spectrum calculated in this state with vanishing discord will be exactly the power spectrum that I obtain in the two-mode squeezed state. So you see, choosing this P means, in fact, that I have a thermal state. But this is a thermal state of pair of particles with k minus k. So I assume that I have a gas of pair of k minus k particles. If I assume this, I can reproduce exactly the power spectrum. So this is the result. And so apparently there is a paradox, because it means that I can reproduce the power spectrum with something which is classical. But I said that the CMB was not classical. Something must be wrong. And therefore, there must be.
There is only for this wave factor, PNM.
Yes, this is only for this PNM. But PNM are free, so I can choose them as I wish.
Generic PNM,
no. But I could say, OK, the initial state of the perturbation was this one. Then I would obtain a power spectrum, which is the one that fits the data. And I would have, this means that I would have explained the data with a quantum state which has a which has a vanishing discord. Here, so this is just a choice here. So to tell you the truth, I know that if you assume this, then you can reproduce exactly the power spectrum. I have not been able to prove that this is the unique choice. So I cannot exclude that other choices for PNM can do the same. I don't know. But something has to be wrong, because I cannot reproduce everything with a non-discordant state. And what is wrong is when I can calculate the correlation function of the derivative of zeta. Because if I calculate the correlation function of zeta prime, using my classical state, I obtain this. And if I calculate it exactly using the two-mode squeezed state, I obtain that. The ratio of the two is huge, exponential 100. So this means that when I calculate zeta prime, I do something which is completely wrong. And this is consistent with the fact that the state has a non-vanishing discord. But I think you have understood the point. The point is that zeta prime is absolutely tiny, as I mentioned before, because we see these peaks. So unfortunately, we cannot check this property with the observation. So it's like knowing that some observation is 10 to the minus 20. You use a wrong theory, and you find that this is 10 to the minus 40. But nevertheless, you cannot check that it is true, because you can never measure something which is 10 to the minus 20. So using these logics, the quantum mechanical origin of the perturbation is hidden from us into the decaying mode of the perturbation. That's the point. None.
No, I mean, in principle, what is the...
In principle. I don't know. I think if you have... No, I know, but I don't know very precisely. But if you have a zeta prime, imagine that zeta prime is not exactly zero. So imagine that you start from a situation where zeta prime is zero, and you progressively, gradually increase the value of zeta prime. What you would see in the observation is gradually the peaks would gradually disappear. So this means that probably for a zeta prime not exactly zero, you have a slight deviation from the exact peaks. But roughly speaking, the deviation from the peak that you would obtain with zeta prime equal to zero and what we have today, the difference between the position of the two peaks, let's say, is something of the order exponential minus 50. So you...
I'm not sure. So you have to see the time derivative of something. What is zeta prime?
But you see you have to see the zeta prime, which is the time derivative, at the time of the last scattering surface. Yes. If zeta prime is not small,
yeah,
you have no peak.
So it should be a continuous thing, right?
Exactly. Yes. But I don't know exactly. What's zeta?
Yeah.
Zeta is, it's the Mukhanov-Sasaki variable, if you wish. Yes. Up to some functions. So theoretically, this is the Mukhanov-Sasaki variable, and observationally, this is delta t over t. So n star is the number of e-folds between the time at which the modes cross out the Hubble radius during inflation and the end of inflation. So it's of the order of 50. Of course, it depends a bit on the parameter, the reheating temperature, and so on, but of the order of 50. So this is, unfortunately, this effect is hidden from us by the because it's hidden in the decaying mode. The last thing I want to do is that, but we have correlations. So let's try another strategy to see the correlations. We have correlations, so maybe I can construct some Bell inequalities. Because if I have quantum correlations, I can maybe see them with Bell inequalities. So can I design an experiment which would test some Bell inequality things in the CMB? So the first thing I can do is to, well, I have a continuous system because the value of the Mukhanov-Sasaki variable amplitude is continuous. Usually, Bell inequalities, they are done with spin. But there is a way to go from a continuous system to, there is a way from a continuous variable system to construct a fictitious spin operator. And this is given by here. So here, Q is some continuous variable. Could be the position of a particle, could be the amplitude of the Mukhanov-Sasaki variable, for instance. So this is only the Z component. So this is the operator that you consider. So I give you the equation and very briefly, because I realize that my time is off. I will explain how you can you can understand this equation. But the thing is that from a continuous variable, you can construct an operator which obeys this. Therefore, this is a spin, because it can give only plus or minus one. So how can I measure it? Well, I take the CMB. So Q is a continuous variable. So this is V of K in my case, the amplitude of the fluctuation. So I take the map. I compute V of K from the map. I look at the value of V of K such that it is in this range because of this integral. So let's say V of K is 2. I have chosen L. L is the coarse grain scale that I have. So I have chosen L. L is fixed by me as an experiment, as an experimenter. And then I find the value of n such that 2 is in this range. I extract the value of n. I calculate minus 1 to the n. And this gives me a measurement of my fictitious spin. So in this way, I can take the CMB and construct a spin variable. There is a well-defined experimental protocol to do this. This is the message. And you can also compute the other component, Sx and Swire. So then you have Sx, Swire, Sz. And therefore, you can compute a Bell operator. The one, you know, when you have Alice and Bob in the experiment that tests the Bell inequality, you construct this Bell operator, which consists in measuring the spins with different angles at Bob's and Alice location. And classically, you know that B is between minus 2 and 2. So what we have done is to calculate the Bell operator in the two-mode squeezed state. And in fact, what we have obtained is a result which is in fact valid for any system placed in a two-mode squeezed state, so not only for cosmology, in fact, because this is a calculation which is valid in that case. And what you obtain is this. For instance, so this is a B for different choices of the coarse grain state, for different value of the squeezing parameter. So this is 2. This is 2 square root of 2, because for those who are familiar with Bell inequalities, you know that in quantum mechanics, you can never go beyond 2 square root of 2. This is the Searle-Son bound. But you see that for some values, you go beyond 2. So you violate the Bell inequalities. So this is a plot of the location in the phi r space, squeezing parameter, squeezing angle, where you can find violation of Bell inequalities. So red part is the part where you find violation of Bell inequalities. So, you know, there is a definite protocol where you can extract SZ from the CMB. And if the state of the fluctuation is a two-mode squeezed state, we should be able to see violation of the Bell inequalities.
So you're
saying this is already observable from the data, or is it calculated? So, I am saying that you can measure SZ from the data. But to measure the Bell operator, you also need SX or SWire. And my claim is that, unfortunately, measuring this object would mean measuring zeta prime. This I have no time to show it. But the same result shows up. If you want to check the Bell inequalities this way, again, the violation is hidden in the decaying mode. Polarization would not help, no. Would not help us, because polarization is not going to tell you what zeta prime is. So I'm sorry I was late, so I conclude.
This may happen to every quantum mechanical observable, but it is tied to the decaying state.
Yes, in fact, you have to measure the momentum, because zeta prime is the momentum.
Right.
So if you have a system in a tabletop experiment, for instance, with lasers or things like that, where you can also have access to the momentum, then this is a valid experimental protocol. This is another way to check that Bell inequalities are violated for those kind of systems. The specificity of cosmology is that the conjugate momentum, or zeta prime, is hidden from us. We cannot measure it in practice. So let me very quickly conclude. So, well, I just repeat, according to cosmic inflation, CMB are placed in a strongly two-mode squeezed state, which is an entangled and strongly discordant state. Discordant meaning having a large quantum discord. Unfortunately, it seems that the signature of the fact that the perturbations are of quantum mechanical origin is hidden in the decaying mode. So as there was, do we have ideas to shortcut these problems? So we are working on two directions. First, the discordance, the classical state that I have introduced is a non-Gaussian state. So it would produce non-Gaussian signal in the CMB. So what we are trying to do now is to calculate the amplitude of these non-Gaussianities. And another idea is to compute the Leggett-Gark inequalities. So very briefly, Leggett-Gark inequalities are time Bell inequalities. So for Bell inequalities, you measure the spin at at the location of Alice and the location of Bell. Leggett-Gark inequality, you always measure the same quantity but at different time.
But you need non-invasive measurements
in the Leggett curve. Yes. Exactly. But the advantage is that you can construct the Leggett-Gark inequalities with only the Z component of the spin that we know how to measure. So if we can construct some Leggett-Gark inequalities only with SZ, maybe there is a hope to measure this object. So, first of all, you have to compute the Leggett-Gark inequalities for a two-mode squeezed state and check that it violates this inequality. So this is what we have done recently, and the answer is yes, it violates, which is, okay, not a surprise, because this is an entangled state. And then you are absolutely right. You have to measure it at different time. And so what we are trying to do now is to design a protocol to measure it, to measure the correlation function of SZ at different redshift. because this, if we could, you know that people are going to probe the power spectrum at different redshift in the future. They are, I mean, for instance, with Euclid, which is an experiment which will come online, which is a very big experiment which will come online in the following years. They will have a tomography of the power spectrum, so they will be able to measure it at different redshifts. So what we hope to do is to use what these people will be able to do and try to apply it to Leggett-Gart inequalities. And my final comment is that, takeaway message, is that inflation, it's very nice to explain the CMB data, but it's also very fun to discuss the foundations of quantum mechanics. Thank you. Thank you.